C is for C12H22O11. For cereal, for candy, for caries, for cavities, for carbohydrates, for calories. The breakfast table was where the seeds of my sorrow were sown. I'm sure that I'm right in locating my first addiction here. Sugar puffs were the starting link in a chain that would shackle me for most of my life. To begin with, as you might imagine, they were a breakfast habit. But soon I was snacking on them at any time of day until my mother began to sigh at the number of packets she was forced to buy. I would eat the sweet pellets loose from the box. One after the other, without stopping, into the mouth they would go. I was like an American at the cinema with popcorn, eyes glazed, hand rising and falling, packed to mouth, packed to mouth, packed to mouth, like a machine. Weekly boxes of sugar puffs, ricicles and frosties would be ordered by my mother over the telephone and delivered, along with the rest of the groceries, by Mr. Neal, who always called me young man. As a result of Mr. Neal's weekly deliveries, I could eat almost as much breakfast cereal as I wanted without having to spend any money. My sugar hit was free. Of course it was. Why wouldn't it be? I was a child who lived in a house where there were always sugar puffs in the cupboard. Perfectly normal and natural. All this changed when, at the age of 7, I was sent to a Gloucestershire preparatory school almost exactly 200 miles from our Norfolk home. My introductory morning at Stout's Hill, for such was the school's name, presented the first in what was to be a long line of disappointments. "You, what are you doing? You should be in the refectory," a prefect shouted at me as I caromed panic-stricken down random corridors.
"Please, what's a refectory?"
The prefect grabbed me by the shoulders and steered me down a passageway and down another and finally through a door that led into a long, low dining room crowded with loudly breakfasting boys sitting on long, shiny oak forms, as benches used to be called. He marched me to one, prized two boys apart, hoisted me up and wedged me into the space between. I sat there blinking with frightened embarrassment. Timidly raising my head, I saw that there was cereal available. Cornflakes or lumpy cooked porridge. Of sugar puffs, frosties and ricicles there was no sign. I might make the claim that life was never the same again, that trust, faith, hope, belief and confidence died in me that day, and that thenceforward melancholy marked me for her own. But perhaps that would be pitching it a touch strong. Nonetheless, I was shocked. Was there now to be no sweetness in my life?